All right, can we get going? Welcome everyone to today's session, which is on the integrity in the service of the church workshop. Can I introduce Dr. Sharon McCallum? Sharon works with us as the Director of NT Professional Standards, and she works obviously to the Bishop, and there is a Professional Standards Committee in the Northern Territory that looks at issues across all the agencies. So it's a mixture of St. Vinny's, Catholic Care, CEO, and obviously the diocese itself. And Sharon also works to the National Professional Standards Office and has been involved in this space since 1997. And so there's a wealth of experience and knowledge around what's occurring not only in the Northern Territory, but what's occurring nationally around this particular issue. Now, this is a workshop that the Bishop is very keen that occurs in the diocese. This is the second group of workshops that we've had. We had the first round of workshops in 2013, and then we've had the follow-up workshops. We had one this morning, one this afternoon. And the main issue that we're focusing on is obviously the document which is service in the, or is titled, Integrity in the Service of the Church. But it's also the way that we tie that document into our document, of which there is two versions, and I was talking to Sharon about. One of Sharon's of the vision, one which is an office version, and one which has a couple of extra, chapters, I'll refer to it that way, for in school. So there are two slightly different versions of it. But the main thing is how we mesh these two documents to make sure that the issues that are important as far as lay working the church are all addressed and everyone is aware of the key issues. And obviously things that are occurring around the country at the moment, still around the Royal Commission. So on that note, Sharon, welcome. Hand over to you. And we are, we do have people Skyping in, and we also are videoing this session so that we were able to send that out to schools. So, I mean, staff in schools actually can watch the session as well, pick up on the information that's that has been given. And it's our first chance to really use the system in a variety of ways. So it's a lot of experimental stuff happening at this time as well. And thank you, Damien, for your work around this space.
Thanks, Greg. This is a big group. I feel like I'm looking down a long tunnel down the end there. So this is to be a participatory workshop. You'll get very bored listening to me for 2 hours, and we'll be doing some stuff at the back end of this that invites you to think about integrity in the service of the church and how it applies in your workplaces. By way of introduction, as Greg said, I'm the Director of Professional Standards. I'm a social worker by training, and being the director for the bishop is actually a fairly small part of my practice. For other jurisdictions, Catholic jurisdictions around the country, I do investigations, we call them assessments, mediations or facilitation, risk assessment, management work, and for other organisations I do stuff in relation to staff performance and misconduct. Greg said, I've been involved in this work since the beginning. We'll start the workshop by giving a bit of background to integrity in the service of the church and where it currently sits within our church, and where the indicators of where our church is going in relation to professional standards. And we're being largely driven that way by the Royal Commission. Now, I'm conscious in the room that most of our participants, and up there on Skype, most of our participants are from Catholic Air. We have a few from Catholic Care, and we have one member of the clergy with us. Can we quickly just go around and just quickly introduce yourself, where you're from? And we'll do the same with Skype for those of you who don't know each other or where you're from. We'll just do that quickly if that's okay. Damien.
My name's Damien. I work for the Catholic Education Office here in IT. I've been with the organisation for just over 10 years now, and I'm just interested in the session and providing IT support for the recording team.
Rhett Bowden from O'Loughlin Catholic College. I'm the head of the senior school.
Mike from Principal Pastoral Care at MacKillop.
Loretta Graham from MacKillop as well, and I'm the principal.
I'm Jeff Perry. I'm a principal's consultant project officer in Catholic Ed Office.
Simon Duffy, the principal of Holy Spirit Primary School here in Darwin. Rose Glennon from the Bishop's Office, Integrity Officer for the Diocese.
Going to talk about you soon, Rose, so I'm pleased to hear to correct me.
Anthony Hockey, St. Paul's Catholic Primary School Principal.
Michelle Dandy, adhere in St. Paul's Catholic School.
Karen Cattell, Deputy at O'Loughlin College.
Matt Burke, APRE at O'Loughlin Catholic College.
Tracy Hare, Catholic Education Office in the Finance Section, looking after the finance system.
Okay.
Petrus, from Asna Paris Priest, Holy Family Paris, Krama.
Elena Shulesko George from Catholic Care, Team Middle Council.
Benedict Morris, Principal Consultant at
Jim John, Principal of O'Loughlin.
Okay. Kathy Hart, Head of Ministry of O'Loughlin.
We don't mind if you're in school services, CEO.
So we have some big heavy hitters in the room, I could see. Oh, and up there on Skype, we have Diane.
Hi, Diane Popovich, Principal at St. Francis Xavier in Daly River. And with me is Fran.
Fran Yenalang, Curriculum Coordinator, St. Francis Xavier, Daly River as well.
Welcome.
Thank you.
And from what ear we have?
Hi, I'm Raylene Fitzgerald, Curriculum Coordinator Secondary.
And Helen Shepherd, I am the Inclusion Support Coordinator here.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Sure. We've got Bernadette on the left. Can you introduce yourself, Bernadette?
Hello, yes, I'm Bernadette from La Ginger Porter, and great. Brother Dan is here with me.
Hello to you all, and Daniel Graves on MCS. He may be muted.
Hi, Daniel. We can't hear you, but hopefully you can hear us.
And that's definitely not test form.
No, I was going to say that's not test form.
Have we got Ben McCasker from Xavier?
Ben McCasker. Yeah, Ben McCasker, Deputy Principal of Xavier College.
Thanks, Ben.
Welcome. Oh, that's me at the end. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, folks. So we're going to travel a bit of ground this morning. We're going to start with a bit of a historical perspective. We're going to then have a look at what's going on in the territory. And then we're going to go to these documents, particularly Integrity and Service of the Church. So let me start by the very beginning. It was in December 1996 that the Australian Catholic Bishops and Catholic Religious Australia wrote their letter of apology, and that was read at all parishes and generally distributed. That letter of apology was directed to victims and families of child sexual abuse. That was the church authorities taking the opportunity to stand up to say that we apologise for what happened and we apologise for the harm done. It was in February the following year, that this document was released. So January it was published, February it was released. It's now been revised, so it now sits in 2010 revision. It's called Towards Healing. This is the document that guides the complaints management process. Any complaint that comes to the Catholic Church via this mechanism, and there's various mechanisms, but this is the preferred option. This is how we manage any complaints that come, generally in relation to religious and clergy. When complaints come in relation to other church personnel, we might reference this, but generally if the person's an employee or a volunteer, there are ministry codes of conduct or grievance dispute or industrial law that takes over. This is our first plank. It's my first obligation in the director's role is to administer this. The next document, so it's complaints management. The next document to come along was Integrity in Ministry. So this document was produced in June 2004. It went through a couple of iterations. This document is essentially a code of conduct for clergy and religious. This document would parallel, I'm a social worker, would parallel our association's code of ethics, and ways of practice. Teachers would have a similar. This is the first time such a document has been released for Catholic personnel, Catholic clergy in Australia. It's generally administered by diocesan officers. Directors of professional standards would often help out in those. It sets out a bit of a response process by which the bishop or religious leader would need to respond to a complaint. So that's that one. This one is the most recent. So this is the third. This is the third process that underpins professional standards for our church. And this one relates to the rest of us. This one relates to all church personnel who aren't clergy and religious. And again, this is essentially a code of conduct for us, us who work in the church for the church. It is again a code of conduct, and it's written under five key principles. Now, obviously, these documents, September 2011, this one's dated, these documents were well in place before the Royal Commission. This one was well underway before the Royal Commission was even promulgated. So this one particularly has become increasingly important across all ministries because we will be audited going forward as a result of the Commission. The Royal Commission into Institutional Sexual Abuse for Children was to be broader than the Catholic Church. It is reasonable to say it has largely been an investigation into the Catholic Church. I heard a statistic last week at the directors' meeting, we have state directors' meetings, that 70% of the Royal Commission's work has been focused on the church, our church. And the Royal Commission was tasked with fact-finding. Fact-finding about what abuse was committed, what child sexual abuse was committed within the Catholic Church by church personnel, and what was our response to it. And following that, the impact on victims and their families and the broader community. If you've been watching the media, you'd be aware that we've not come out of that looking too flash. We've come out of it having been found wanting in our response to child sexual abuse and in how well we've delivered services to children and their families of victims. More concretely, it is hard to defend against the Royal Commission, as unfair as it might have gone about its process. We cannot defend against it. We have had child sexual abuse committed by Catholic clergy and religious and covered up by Catholic clergy and religious. We know that is fact. And so the Royal Commission is now reaching its culmination point for our church. The Catholic wrap-up will happen in February of next year. And right now, the process is underway for how our church is going to respond to that. So that will be a public release of documents. I think there'll be a public hearing where the Commission will deliver its findings or make its pronouncements about the church, and then there will be a response made. So the people who are going to make that verbal response will appear as well. So that's February next year. The Royal Commission has gathered information from several sources, primary sources, public hearings, private hearings, and written submissions. And for anyone wanting to talk about our church, they have until September to do that. After September, the Royal Commission will close off any new information coming to it about our church. I guess they might respond to it. Last I heard, which is probably going back a month or two, maybe 3 months, the commission at that time still had 1,500 complaints in relation to our church that had not yet heard. They had not yet responded to. And I think the information is still rushing. So it's big, and it has been a major source of work for many, many, many people in our church. Royal Commission was proclaimed, promulgated. The church responded by setting up the Truth, Justice and Healing Council.
The Truth, Justice and Healing Council is our body, and it's the conduit of information from all church entities to the Royal Commission, unless the Royal Commission makes direct approach to a diocese or religious. So they're the two bodies that are managing this process, and the rest of us are responding to it. What we see already coming out of the Commission is various position papers. It's calling for submissions, but it's arriving at positions. So you may have noticed that some that have emerged that are key to our work. One was the call for a national compensation or investigatory body to which all complaints would go, which would remove them from our church. The issues paper currently is calling for information for submissions in relation to how the church deals with things like celibacy, confessional, various other things. And the issue paper it's produced will be sent to the Holy See for their comment, and they're apparently great interest in knowing what's going on. So this is big. We know this is big. Certainly it's central to the work of directors. The ramifications of it will be equally as big. We've seen in the past a Royal Commissions, and the one relevant up here, of course, is deaths in custody, come go, and I think the stat runs that the Deaths in Custody Royal Commission had 101 recommendations. Now that it's reviewed 20 years later, only one or two have been enacted. That they largely are very expensive process out of which nothing changes. I don't think that'll be the case with this current one. So we'll have some tangible things that will come out that will have changed for us, and I'll talk about those. But the more immediate thing we've had to deal with is that in the eyes of many members of our public, we are no longer a trusted entity. We are no longer a trusted church. Now, many would see our church as having provided places where abuse and harm could happen, and that we covered it up. And it's hard to defend against that. It's very hard to defend against that. We have a legacy to deal with now. And there's more to come. There will be more that will emerge. And it would be easy to think it's kind of out there and not here. Recently, and I'm not going to ask people to keep this information kind of private amongst ourselves because I wouldn't want to hurt anyone as a result of it. But it was brought home to me recently that we in the Territory don't escape this. So what happened? Someone at Catholic Ed took a phone call here last year would be great, very recently, from a very distressed mother alleging that her boy was sexually abused on a school camp, one of our camps, between 10 and 15 years ago. And that that we knew about the abuse and we covered it up and we lied to her and her family at the time. And that now the boy, who's now a young man, had come forward to say, in fact, he was sexually abused. So I spoke, that call comes to me, as those ones do. I spoke, the opportunity to speak very briefly. In the background, Greg's scrambling to find files about this matter here so we can have a look and see what actually happened. Because she did say that she told the school at the time, the school gave her an answer, and Cathy gave an answer that it didn't happen. And now she was saying that's not true, you lied to me. So I spoke with her briefly and said that our response always in these matters is to take the matter to the police and to encourage the complainant to go, and that we would provide the opportunity for her to go, we would go with her, we would do whatever we needed to do to get this to the police. She was at work, so she asked me to call her back. In spite of calling her, trying lots of times, eventually got her. Now, my background is child protection, and coming up to my 35th year in this work that I do, she abused me like I've not been abused before.
She tore me up and down and screamed and yelled. The kinds of things that she, the themes that emerged were that that back then she was lied to, that her boy was sexually abused, that the school knew, that Kath Ed knew and lied about it, was covering it up, and that I was complicit in that, and she didn't trust that I was going to help her or that we could be trusted at all. And she said things like, I trusted you lot. I trusted you lot with my boy. And now I find you've done this. And this boy is a drug user. And it's all your fault. And I've been listening to the media and you can go on and on and on and on. And I thought, I guess if you're the parent of a child and your beautiful boy has become a drug user, and he tells you that, in fact, he was sexually abused 10 or 12 years ago, and you've been listening to all the media, and so you're starting to get some doubts about the honesty and the justice of our internal systems, and all of a sudden there comes an explanation about why your beautiful boy looks like he's trying to slowly kill himself in front of you, it's easy to grab hold of this. It's easy to grab hold of. It must have happened. When Greg found the files, Catholic Ed and the school responded absolutely perfectly. That what happened was this person, parent teacher, had he was on the school camp, he'd gone in swimming with the kids, come out, had quickly gone to the changed area to get changed, had thought there were no kids in there, whipped his strides off, was putting on dry ones and was spotted by two boys, of which this was one. But this boy yelled out something to the fellow, like, I don't know, a flasher or something. That parent volunteer immediately reported it to the school, teacher from the camp, who immediately reported it up. Investigation was done. Parents were informed. Apology made. The process was followed perfectly. There was response from the record that the parents, accepted the apology. Done, dusted, clean process, well done. But none of that stops us 10 or 12 years on being accused of cover-up. She was so suspicious of me that she did not trust me to even take the matter to the police on her behalf. She wanted nothing to do with us, even taking it to the police. And I wanted to say, I'm a good guy, I'm trying to get this to the police. I wasn't having a bar of it. Not a bar of it. So the lesson for me in that was, you know, we kind of sit away from the main action, and we're different, and we're a church that is close to Christians. This isn't us. But my learning is it is us. There's a couple of issues bubbling around the Royal Commission right now that may well draw us in. In the future, the territory so far, we've escaped it. We've not had to answer any notices to produce, like a subpoenas. We've had to provide lots of general information about the various things, but we've not had a specific subpoena. But we know that Royal Commission teams are up on particular Aboriginal communities looking for complaints, and I've started to get contact from legal firms who have identified victims of abuse and are wanting to run it civilly, not through towards him. We want straight lawyer to lawyer money transaction. So boarding schools has come up. Spoke with Greg about it. First I heard about boarding schools being of interest to the Royal Commission was yesterday. Greg says it's been around 6 months, a bit longer than that. If the Royal Commission's paying attention to not one of our schools in the territory. If they decide to broaden that and they send out a notice to reduce across boarding schools, we're in that where we've certainly had complaints produced from our schools. So it's a front and centre issue, folks, is my point. For me, the purpose of the session is to introduce you to this document, but it's bigger than that. this is our opportunity as church going forward to perhaps make more public the work we've already been doing, but to, I didn't want to say clean up our act. Most of the complaints that I deal with, the Royal Commission deals with, are events that happened many years ago. The average age of complaint that we get within the church of abuse by clergy and religious is something like 45 years old, maybe longer than that. Most of the complaints are on. We've investigated in territory complaints of events that are alleged to have happened 60 and 70 years ago. The more, we don't get so many recent ones for a number of reasons. We don't have so many clergy and religious teaching in schools, but very few. We don't have the big Catholic-run institutions that we used to have. Catholic Church provided more residential care for children in Australian history than any other entity beyond probably state governments. Catholic Church, by far, had more institutions, and that equates to more access and opportunity. So we're talking about historical. We're being judged by today's standards, and that's the position we're in right now. Going, just making sense? Am I saying anything that's new? Do you have a different point of view? What's your reading of the media and the scrutiny we're subjected to and its aftermath?
I didn't realise the Catholic, well, I knew the Catholic Church was one of the main focuses, but I thought that there were a lot more. When you say that there are 70% of focuses on us, so I thought there was a lot of other organisations as well that were being focused. I didn't realise we were the main target as such.
It's been talked about anecdotally because almost always the background for the media is there will be some Catholic icon. So it's been that kind of talk. Certainly others have. Salvation Army had a public hearing. Others had. What we don't see so much, though, is the depth of scrutiny we've had. But I think that's where the Catholic Church looks like one entity. We don't see is how many notices to produce and private inquiries have been going on. Yeah, 70% was what we were told the other day. Yeah. The history to this was that...
Just a question then. So 70% of the scrutiny is on the church, and what's the statistics say about the percentage of child sex abuse complaints per organisation? Do we represent 70% of the complaints?
Not sure about the answer. If I say that... Because out of this, one of the questions arises, is our institution any more abusive than any others? A Catholic clergy and religion any more abusive than the other population? The answer to that is no. As best anyone can tell, and if it's really hard, there is no definitive research on this. If anyone knows of any, let me know. I understand most research to say that across a population, somewhere like 7 to 8% of the male population are abusers. It is certainly no higher for clergy. In fact, some would say it may be a percentage. So our clergy and religious are no more likely to abuse a child than any other population of men. Women's stats are a whole different. They're much lower for child sexual abuse. Having said that, much less scrutiny. So proportionally, I don't think we're any more. Answer your question, but our volume looks big. Our volume is big. It's really hard to defend against this, is it? Because we know this has happened, and we know some religious leaders and bishops covered it up. So here we are right now. So let's look, where are we going? What does this mean for us going forward? One of the things we've been accused of, and perhaps rightly so, is that we are not responsible enough or honest enough
as an entity to do our own complaints management or to even do our own auditing about how we're safe church. You might have noticed that the Commission called for a Commonwealth commitment or government commitment to take over the complaints management process particularly and auditing. And I should say, mental professional standards are talking two arms. The first arm is the complaints management, and that's ongoing. So that's this one. That's one major arm, one arm. The other arm, though, to professional standards is a more recently emerging one, and that's one that's now having more resources put to it. This is called safeguarding. So under the safeguarding arm falls things like this. Under the safeguarding arm falls all those processes that have been in place but will be put in place more now that signals that we are a safe church and we can demonstrate it because we have in place a series of policies and processes and responses to make a safe church. So Sister Rose for the Territory has been appointed as our integrity officer. Rose, tell me if I'm wrong here, but Rose's responsibility to which she works for the bishop is to ensure all our Catholic ministries are putting in place practices and process that we can demonstrate make us a church, our ministries, that are safe spaces for children of all people. Rose? Mm-hmm. So the Royal Commission went to the Commonwealth Government, media saying they wanted a national body funded to oversee complaints management and the safeguarding work, what do you call safeguarding? Follow this, the Commonwealth came back very quickly and said, not us, and sent it to the states. The states so far have not agreed that they will fund and run a body that will hear complaints from any entity, not just the Catholic Church, and provide a response. Again, last week we were told that some of the states are still jockeying around that. Some have said no. Some have said I will if they will. Some have said I will if. But basically no one's yet put on the table that they will run a government-funded, independent complaints management and auditing process. There's a lot of speculation that they want because it is very costly. The equivalent would be exists in Victoria called the Health Commission, which is a body which anyone can complain to about poor practice or ethical misconduct by anyone in the health professions. Very expensive to run. Commonwealth government and state governments do not like to put in any regulatory bodies for any profession because they're so expensive to run. The compensation costs and the legal costs that arise out of a national entity to take care of this work are massive. The other reason, someone this morning said the other reason that they doubt a government organisation will take this up would be that it implicates them and makes them liable in the future for any work they don't do. So how our church has responded, the head of Truth, Justice and Healing Council, the chair is Justice Neville Owens, the CEO is Francis Sullivan. They're in regular dialogue with the Royal Commission and they think that they know where the Commission is going to be heading in the wrap-up next year. The church has responded by putting in place as recently in the last week or two with final sign-off yet to happen, an entity that will take carriage of professional standards for the church. So it's a separate entity within the church. It is for the church. Because if the church doesn't provide its own process, no one else will. You know, if we say we can't be trusted to run something, let's shut it down, all we get then is vacant space. Many of the complaints that we get would never meet a threshold that the police seem interested in. Either because the accused is dead, or there's just not enough evidence to run, or they're not criminal. So the church is sort of stepping the space, and then we're going forward.
We're going to continue to run complaints management, and we're going to beef up this safeguarding summary. Until, I guess, a government department or government body or Commonwealth decides how to take it over. One of the outcomes of that, we'll see that out of this safeguarding arm will come auditing. And every church ministry will be audited against a set of national standards. So what we've just finalised at the national level is the National Child Protection Standards, which will be applicable to every ministry. So every ministry will have to demonstrate on audit that they're meeting those. Even right now, we have had to provide reports to the Commission and to Truth, Justice and Healing about how we're meeting our obligations to meet our own policies like these. As recently as last week or two, Rose and Malcolm, the Bishop, and I had to produce information back to the Truth, Justice and Healing, going to the Commission, about what in-service training or professional standards processes we run to monitor standards in the diocese. We'll see more of that. We'll see much more of that. How it'll look, no one's sure yet, but there will be looking at it. And we'll be audited against these, because that's all our church has. We'll be audited against them. That's where we are right now. Hence the importance of workshops like this. July is when this new body will take it. We'll supposed to be start 1st of July. I think they're having trouble just ticking all the legal boxes to set it in place. Certainly actioned by next year that we'll have these auditing bodies. So this is real. It's front and centre. For me, it's certainly me and Rose right here. So how does that play out for you on the ground here? I don't know, 2 or 3 years ago, the Bishop asked ministries to demonstrate that every Catholic ministry in the NT was upholding this integrity service of the church. And most ministries went through a mapping exercise, because most ministries would have codes of conduct that operate or their own internal documents. So ministries were sent away to map their processes against this, which was duly done for Catholic. Greg did, and it was done, I think Catholic Care did the same. I'm looking at Rose and Lizzie. Parishes are still working towards it, I understand, but the Catholic ministries, we haven't. So what that's resulted in is these documents. There's two. One exists for people working in schools. One exists for admin staff. So and I'm sorry I didn't think to do this with Catholic Care, but if you bear with this and participate, even with Catholic staff, if that's all right. So what I thought we'd do now is we'd start to have a look at both documents. We're going to look at how they work together, they marry together, the comments you would make. This morning's group had some comments to make about them. And then we're going to go on and talk about how do we implement them. What does it look like on the ground? Before I go there, any comments? Feedback from what I've said so far? What's it been like for you working in this kind of environment? Has it been noticeable? Have you noticed anything different, or is it not impacting on you?
Amongst other things, the students call you now pedophile is one they call.
Really?
Yep. And they feel abuse, that's one term of abuse that they'll use.
Yeah. So some priests and clergy tell me the same. That they're now things said to them going through airports if they're wearing any identifying clothing or something. Anyone else? Yeah. You getting a feedback from parents on this?
No, it was different. I was just thinking, I'm interested in you using the word defend. What do we defend? Because we know it's true.
Yeah.
And yet, it's not always as true as what people say it is.
and that's, you've exactly nailed the point through this. We can't defend it because it's true. Abuse happened. It is also true that the Royal Commission is presenting a biased view, a biased position on this, and that there's legal firms that have been set up to do nothing more than bring people before the Commission. And the terms of reference for the Commission have been so stretched now that while it was set up to deal with child sexual abuse, it's gone well beyond that. The other thing it's done is that I'd understood Royal Commissions to be a legal place where cross-examination of facts would occur. That doesn't happen. So victims are essentially, anyone who's alleging abuse is essentially vulnerable. And I have been in touch with enough of the cases that have been under scrutiny to know that not all the story has been told. And I'm really conscious as I say this that it sounds like I'm saying abuse didn't happen. I am absolutely not. No one knows me as I know, or somebody, but I know it's happened. But not all the stories are true. Even the position the Royal Commission Treat Justice and Healing and take has taken on towards healing just said it's failed. It's actually not true. What wasn't known, even by directors of professional standards until recently, is that many of the cases that were supposed to come to this never did. Bishops and religious leaders sent them off in a different direction, often to pay them out, essentially. So there's some of the processes that make us look a lot worse than we are. So you can't introduce something, and it was a cover up.
One comment, these were put in place to deal with things that average 45 years ago. So these were put in place from 20 years up to 5 or 6 years ago to deal with matters that are 45 years old. And now these are being criticised because they didn't deal adequately with the things that happened 45 years ago. So we have to put in place new things. That does seem a bit absurd to me. I mean, it's not that they've been tried and found wanting. They haven't been tried because they weren't in place 45 years ago. I'll just throw that forward.
Yeah, look, it's a difficult space to even have the conversation, but I can say that I started my career in child protection in 1983 for the Queensland Department of Child Protection. In 1983, we all, in our first induction, we were all trained in how to investigate physical abuse of children, emotional abuse of children, and neglect. Child sexual abuse was not included. State Government Department of Queensland did not investigate child sexual assault until at least 84, 85. Queensland was probably a couple of years later than other states. I think South Australia was the first in 1979. So that's within my career. So it is really difficult to look at child sexual abuse and the response to it 40 or 50 years ago. Exactly the point being made. This is what we're at. We're at this point now.
I think for me, one of the issues is, and it's happening here possibly, it is very difficult for us to have a response to it, because whatever you would say about it is going to someone who's critical of the church or critical of how the church is handling it, is not going to be well received. It's very difficult, as you've explained, it would be seen, and I find that it would be seen that we're defending the church.
Mm-hmm.
And then if that's perceived at all, then you can be in a lot of trouble from the other side coming at you about it. And so that conversation is very difficult to have in any context, but this is what we have at the moment.
Yeah.
However, I haven't found in schools that parents have treated us differently. I haven't found that.
Mm-hmm.
I think that the parents can see that the people on the ground are the same people who were there for the last 10 years or
yeah.
last so many years. They know where we've come from, and they don't treat us differently.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, because it's been in the media a lot, we get more comments that you might hear out there that you don't like.
From children.
from children, but not from parents.
Yeah. Okay.
I haven't heard any from children, but in that of that nature. But you get the sense that there's a more discussion around it, whereas before it wouldn't have been.
Yeah. Okay. I've heard some recent stuff. I'm not sure about the territory, but the Catholic, the number of parents wanting to send their kids to Catholic schools is exploding.
Yeah.
So you're doing a lot right.
We've got one of our teachers from St. Olympias in Ballarat. He's talked quite openly about the experience and the experience of his colleagues back in Ballarat right now. So it's been quite touching. Well, it's really been a real raw story to some of our teachers.
Yeah. And that probably is our most public, I don't know if it's our biggest failing, because who knows what other failings have been, but certainly that's been one of our most public worst failings that Bishop Mulcairn's knew and did.
I think the other side of it is that, I suppose, because I'm in this role, and it gets raised with me in different stages, and it's a lot around how can you work for an organisation. You don't try to defend the church because you can't. It occurred. So you take that note and say it occurred, it shouldn't have occurred, the people who have done the wrong thing should be taken to court, jailed for that, and that's an historical thing. But you focus on, since the church has been dealing with it, that, as far as we know, very little of anything has happened at all. So the historical is historical, and as you said, most of the stuff that's coming up is from the, I don't know, 60s, 70s, probably early 80s. But there's not a lot after that. So you can't defend the church, and I don't think anyone should try, because it is clearly there. On the same token, I mean, I've worked in up here 30-plus years, and I've worked with a lot of priests, nuns, and brothers whose commitment to what they've done is exemplary, and you talk about that as well. But, you know, yes, they're, and it's not a case of bad apples. There are people that have done the wrong thing, but there are many more people that have dedicated their lives to the church and to their work. And if you look at what's happened since a lot of this stuff has come in into place, then I think the church is able to stand quite strongly on the recent record. So, as I said, you don't try to defend the history. The history is the history.
Yes.
Match up later on when we're talking about them.
So hopefully before you, what you have are three things. You have an integrity and service of the church. Blue one, you have just the orange one, and you just have this one pager, which is really just a quick reference. So how integrity and service of the church is written, there's a preamble. Lays out five preamble. The preamble includes what should happen if there's a breach of the guidelines, and then it goes through five principles that are the basis of this. And each principle is introduced by a piece from the gospel or a comment in relation to the gospel. I hate it when people are read aloud to me because I can read myself. So I'll let you read. Don't read. This is probably the quickest thing to read. Yeah. Just read and we'll come back to it to talk. I'll give you 5 minutes or a few minutes to read.
Our digital friends only lost 5 minutes. No, we had a computer issue.
You might want to tell the ones on Skype that to read through the email version.
For those of you who are on Skype, can you hear me? Can you just wave if you can hear me?
We can hear you, but can't see you.
Oh, okay. So waving is not going to help you, is it? No.
That's the one that was emailed.
One of the documents.
We actually don't know. We don't know what you can see at your end.
Yeah, we've just lost.
I can see Diane and I can see everybody.
Hi, Diane.
The documents we're looking at are, there's a blue covered one called Integrity and Service of the Church, and Greg emailed that to you yesterday. Your hard copies are here. Oh, this morning.
Yeah.
Your hard copies are here, but you have an email one that Greg sent this morning.
Yep. We do.
Good. And then Damien asked if you could
find the sharers of the vision documents to have it in front of you.
Yep.
Yep.
Yep. And that.
But we want the one without the picture at the bottom. We want the one that has for admin staff. I think you're looking, Diane, I think you're looking at the one for teaching staff.
That's maybe.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Yep. And the third document, I think Greg also emailed, yes, which is a one page back and front, which is an overview of integrity and service of the church. We'll start with some general comments, then we'll move to some more specific comments. What jumps out at you when you read either or both of those documents, Integrity and Service of the Church and the Cathed Sharers of the Vision? What would be your opening comments you would make?
Catholic social justice.
Catholic social justice from both? Both, okay. This one, remembering, the Integrity and Service of the Church is written across to apply to all ministries. All ministries, whereas yours has been mapped for you. Both about social justice is one comment. What other comments would you make?
Very much about protection of the vulnerable.
Yeah, protection of the vulnerable. Yeah, both of them, or?
I was reading the summary sheet.
Yeah. Yep.
So they're the headings for this stuff.
Yeah.
In section 3, I find interesting about the responsibility that the worker has to take to their own professionalism.
Yeah. Yeah. So point 3 in here. Principle 3. And principle 5, hey, also about making sure they're personally and professionally competent. Similar. One of the things that I guess because I work with codes of conduct across various entities and codes of ethics, when I look at the integrity and service of the church, for me it's just a blur of words. They're words that, you know, if I leave out church workers, you can pick up and use this
in any health and profession organisation, pretty much. And I guess that's designed to be, but I don't find this a document that particularly grabs me in knowing how to action it. Like, what do you do? What are we to use the call to do? So I do find your document a little more focused, which is good. That would be what the comment I would make, but then this one's not designed to apply to every ministry specifically. Now, going forward, and when we go to auditing, so we'll be audited against this. I'm assuming this will be one of the documents we'll be audited against because we don't have any others yet. So if I, where we're going to go to now, we're going to imagine I'm the auditor and that I'm visiting your ministries. And so here I am, I'm auditing you against Principle 1. Church workers are committed to justice and equity. So I arrive at your ministry and I say, show me, show me how you do this. Show me how you every day in your work achieving Principle 1. What could you show me? What could you give me to demonstrate that you're doing? Now, we can do this as a large group or small group. In such a large group, what's your preference? Small? Large? Sorry, Jim?
I was just going to make a comment.
Okay.
I suppose one of the things that we would be able to show is that we have a school code of conduct. We're constantly reminding all the school community about it. And we, in particular with leaders, we're reminding the staff to ensure that it is enacted, which is all about fairness and justice.
Okay. And as a, we play devil's advocate, and as an evaluator, I say that's great. You're showing me an input. You're showing me that you have a code of conduct. You're showing me some throughput. You're showing me what you're doing. What would I see? We'll direct this to all of you. Get Jim a point. What would I see as an outcome? What would I see that says, yes, as a result of the code of conduct and us constantly reminding staff, we are seeing a high level of professional conduct? What would I see? What would I see as the impact on it? Because you could be an organisation that has a code of conduct, does lots of reminding, but it's not behaving properly, just and equitable. So what would I see that tells me it had an impact?
Actually, the way people deal with each other.
Okay, what would I be looking for?
If you happen to be in the front office of the school, you'd see a lot of interaction, whether it was staff, parents, teachers, students.
Okay.
And you would be looking at the way, the manner in which people dealt with each other.
Okay, all right.
Behaviour management policies.
Okay. What would those behaviour management policies be? What would a good one say? What would it be demonstrating?
When you're dealing with a behaviour management issue, we have a restorative justice's approach, real justice, and that you want that approach. How that's taken in cases, because it's all about justice and fairness.
Okay, all right.
Transparency and consistency of applications.
Okay, regardless of the child, regardless of the school, would be the same.
No, because that might be part of the fairness, it's the context-specific application, but it would be transparency and consistency in responding to it.
Okay. Now, that's an interesting point. The group this morning talked about that in order for something to be just, it may not be equal. So how would, if I was going to one of your schools that's dealing with a particularly disadvantaged community, location, what would I see that I mightn't see in another school? Demonstrate equity. What I see is different. Might be, yeah.
Support services, other support services that are coming into the school from CEO or others.
Okay. So I might see more of those around, more ancillary support, yeah?
Well, certain resources in the school are allocated.
Okay, what does that mean?
If you've got a large group of disadvantaged students, it might be low ethnic background, low literacy and numeracy, the school may allocate additional resources to those students to try to bring that up as quickly as possible.
Okay.
Choice within the school about how they allocate the resources.
Okay. All right. What else?
You might see different groups of people that are part of decision-making processes. It might look different in different contexts.
Okay. Give me an example.
Well, in a, say, in an urban school, you'd have a whole lot of representative groups who participate in decision-making about the behaviour management policy, and in a community, that representative group would still be evident, but it might be different irrespective of the community who's representative. So like we have a board, but it looks very different in an urban context, a representative board, than it might in, say, an Indigenous community.
What do I see in Catholic care? If I'm the auditor of Catholic care, what would I say?
I'm in the principle three, the third principle. The church workers are committed to safe and supportive relationship. For me, this is the most important one. And you said that the principle is church workers to observe, I mean, to know and to understand and to respect. How you're making people to know and to understand and to respect. So how you support the workers to understand and to know and to respect, and how they can observe all this so they can comply with all this. Not just to write down that you should do that, you should do this, but how you support workers not to do, you know, opposite way.
Okay, yeah. Well, and let's just continue this conversation on point three. So what would I see then? Like, what would I see that would tell me Catholic care is supporting workers to do it justly? What would I see?
Professional development and a supervision. I mean, you cannot work with people in the right way, and you cannot support parents or children in your role if you don't have professional development as supervision. You need to develop yourself as a professional when working with people, so you can be very clear with the boundaries, which is the third. And I think the problem with all the abuse of the children is basically the, you know, physical, emotional boundaries and blurring of these boundaries. This is a basic problem that happened.
That's right. Yeah.
And from my perspective, it's not just the victim, it's the child. The victim also is the person that committed. So perpetrators should also be treated as a victim or their own history, and how we are not support them not to do the same, because you have a modeling from adult. If you were abused, you will abuse another person. This is the model that you learn through your life. So you need to gain a different kind of personal experience, like emotional relationship. And teachers and people in school are quite important from the perspective of attachment theory. So if you didn't have a bonding of attachment in your primary family, you could gain this in school from a person that is quite important for you. It could be a teacher, it could be a principal, it could be, you know. This is quite important. So the role in the school is very responsible and important role if you are obliged yourself to do this kind of job. So it's an easy one.
It's a really good point. I'll pick that up when we get over to principle three, because I think that it's getting harder and harder for schools to be able to pick up some of that work now. It's my what I see from the outside, but we'll come back to that if that's okay. Just wanting to blow out of time a little bit. Okay. Any comments from Skype people? No? Just butt in if you have any comments. Let's go to principle two. So, church workers uphold the dignity of all people
and their right to respect. Again, I'm walking through your schools or ministries. What would I see? What's your tangible evidence that you're doing this?
I guess it is that basic thing of how you communicate to your parent community and your student community and your agencies that are working in your school. That if you're yelling, screaming and all that, that's not exactly what that's saying. So then we have to be treating you in respect on a daily occurrence. So mm-hmm. it's a very simple modelling of our behaviour.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, what the phrase that jumps out at me, I'm always conscious when I'm talking with a bunch of teachers that I'm not sure if it's a phrase or three words, but anyway, three words here that jump out at me, diversity and difference.
And embrace diversity.
Yes, so we're embracing diversity and difference. Now, this morning I raised this point and was told that your school's current stats, 53% of students have English language other than English as their first language.
Yeah, from the stats that we discussed yesterday, according to ACARA, but we expect it would be much higher than that, obviously, in Indigenous Catholic community schools, but that's what's important.
So more than half of the pupils in your school, students in your school, come from diverse, different. What would I see? I don't know what's it like for Catholic care. What would your numbers run at? No, that's okay. That's right. Let's stay with schools. So what would I see that would tell me that you're embracing diversity and difference in regard to cold communities?
It can be as simple as the practicalities of interpreters, the way you set up your parent meetings is so that your interpreter sits here and they can sit with them.
Mm.
And that's freely available to parent teacher interviews, reader reports, all those sort of processes as well. Certainly the process of, obviously, I've taught many multicultural schools, and that celebrating the cultures that are within the school in some way, especially Harmony Day is quite celebrated here in the Northern Territory, but certainly I've worked in schools with high African numbers, so we do celebrate some of the festivals and ceremonies and that part of that culture too. It's a big part of your school.
Okay. What could you do better? Do you think you're doing it as well as you could, or could it be better?
My response to that would be, I think the use of interpreters could be better here in the Northern Territory.
Okay.
But our system's right, that parents would know how to get an interpreter if they need one.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that's something we could probably pick a little bit up here.
Okay. One of the suggestions that came out this morning was that it might be helpful to send the key important school notices out in languages other than English. Key languages, so that parents weren't relied on kids first remembering to give them the note or translating it for them.
Interestingly, there's some recent research that actually said, we looked at the parents.
They don't want that.
That's interesting. And that where they wrote the newsletter, and they said, no, we chose to bring part of the newsletter written in English.
Okay.
That it was embarrassing.
Ah, righto. Okay.
It's easy to talk to a relative and pretend that they could do the language there.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, that's what they wanted to engage in that context.
Yeah. Well, that's interesting.
And maybe the translations aren't very good. I don't know. There might have been lots of reasons.
Yeah.
And there's time frame behind it as well. By the time you get off to the interpreting service, get it back.
I think that in order to embrace diversity and difference, you really do need to know the people in your class or in your year level or in your school. So taking time to get to know the families and to know more than just their name or their number.
Mm-hmm.
Because how can you embrace diversity if you don't know the first thing about families? And I think we have to work further than the classroom. We have to be interested further than the classroom.
Otherwise,
it's impossible.
Is it doable? Is that doable to get to know
kids and their families more than in the classroom?
Is it doable? I think that it is doable to a certain extent. I think that aspire to doing it in order to do it to any degree. If we don't believe that it's important, then obviously we won't achieve any part of that. I really truly believe it's part of what we're called to do in Catholic education. I was just looking through and looking at the actual dot points in here that don't appear in here, and wondering why there's some that aren't. Does it mean that these aren't important enough to be here, or were they missed in our initial conversation? So, and whether or not it's because it's not doable, or whether it's not important, or whether it's not seen as part of our charter any longer. So,
I might have explained it badly. So are you wondering why parts of this are not included in this?
Parts, the dot points in here, like I can imagine that not all of these need to be included in here. That's true, because that would have been part of the discussions that were had. But I'm interested in the reason behind why they aren't in there, or why they weren't come to the attention in order to be included.
Yeah, I do.
I just asked, it's the opposite to what you're asking about, whether it's doable, and my response being
is that one not included?
If they're doable or not is not really the question. It's whether or not we aspire to doing it. We might not be able to do all of it or do it really to the level we want, but is it something we still aspire to do? And then that linked me to, so if these points don't appear in here, does it mean that we're not aspiring to do that, or they were just missed, or they hold little importance? That's the question I throw back in response.
And I must have not been clear. This document preceded this document. Oh, sorry. This document preceded this one.
Yeah.
So, and there's been no process by which this blue one, which is this one, could pick up that.
Yeah, but I'm looking at the sharers of the vision here. And the ones that are missing on this document
And
so I'm saying, like, do we still aspire to all of these? And I'm just interested in why some of them aren't in here. That's over to you.
So you're going to come to me. My memory of it, this is 3 years ago, is that when we did the mapping exercise, it was to make sure that what was in the integrity in the service of the church was picked up in our shares of the vision. But there are additional things in our shares of the vision, and we weren't mapping. It has been rewritten or new thoughts included, but I was trying to think back whether it was 2013 or 2014. If there were things in the shares of the vision that didn't actually map into this cleanly, they were left out.
Yeah.
They weren't left out because they weren't important. It was the intent when we first did the mapping was to make sure everything that was here somewhere picked up in this document, but there are additional things in this document as well.
Okay.
Yeah. So nothing was regarded as not being important, but we wanted to make sure that if this document is a key document from the church's perspective for laity working in the church, that we needed to know that all of these headings were picked up in shares of the vision, and so that's the way the mapping was done.
I suppose when I look at this, I would say that some of these points are difficult to achieve. They are doable to probably a lesser extent than what we would desire, but still we aspire to them, So it's there's a lot of things in life like that, I suppose.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. And certainly nothing wrong with being aspirational.
And I suppose in point two, the challenge for us is our prejudices and our biases. And I suppose when I look at different faces of families and children in our schools, there would be some that would question 2.2.
Okay.
So if you're a child with same-sex parents, if you're a child dealing with transgender issues, if you're a child who has a parent who perhaps has been incarcerated, you know, you can think of a whole lot of different faces in our schools that I think would perhaps challenge 2.2. We've got a lot of work, I think, as a community, church community.
Okay.
It's probably generational issues too, isn't it? Just even in a staff group, there's generational issues.
And some of the language that we use, and sometimes that just requires a lot of education about how we talk about humanity, the language that we use to. And that requires, I think, a lot of professional work because it's not through a lack of intent. I'd say there's a lot of intent. Sometimes it's the ignorance and the capacity of people to engage in the issues that are being put.
Language is such an important thing, doesn't it? Language changes. Language is... I work around the country, and there are some states that if I called... Australian Indigenous people Aboriginal, I would be criticised.
Mm-hmm.
At times in the Territory, when I work in here, if I call Aboriginal people Indigenous, I'm in trouble. In Queensland, if I were to use the language Koori, I'd be in trouble. If I was a white woman in some circles use the words Murray, I'd be in trouble. Like sometimes I think, what is the right word?
Yep.
And what was okay 5 years ago is not okay now. So I think that's a really good point of just having updated what is the appropriate language. And I think there is an accusation that can be made about political correctness, but it is about culture changes, doesn't it? And how we include people changes, and language is one of them. But it's not easy.
And it's not particular to the church, because we know that our political leaders are really struggling to frame some of the issues with the language of expected leadership. Yeah, so it's not specific to the church. I think it's a global threat.
Yeah. Let's go on to 3.3, because I think this is an interesting one. And I'll take up the point. Just a second. So what was your first name?
Yelena.
Sorry. Yelena raised about that schools. There's about 30 different points we could raise out of this, but we'll use Yelena's because it's an interesting entree. So Yelena's point was that schools can be a place where kids' needs for attachment can be met. And in the absence of any other opportunity, that might be the place they meet. And my comment was, I think it's more difficult to do that these days than it was in the past. And the reason I think that is because I think, particularly for men, we've reached this time in our society's history where men, rightly so, are worried about false accusation. And we've also reached this time that all professions are doing it, which is very strong boundaries between providers of a service and recipients of a service, social workers and clients, teachers, students, and that in some, the word this morning was used as aloof, that often now us as whichever caring or helping or teaching role we're in might appear to be aloof. It's because we've created this big boundary. What's your comment?
I just find that amusing to some degree because that was one of the accusations made against clergy in the past, particularly members of religious orders, that they tended to be aloof, that they didn't engage the children, and that they lacked that human loving touch. So, gone through a whole period, and we're back where we started. Only we're back where we started with lay people rather than religious orders.
Yeah.
Just an observation.
Yeah,
Well, let's start out with the proposition I make, and that we're talking about. What's your views about that? Where do you think we're at the moment for us as people working with
people who are less powerful than us?
I think people are very conscious of it, that of creating that distance. I've numerous staff who say, you know, they won't be in a room on their own, they won't do this, or if I'm taking an excursion or camp, should I take another male teacher, should I take a female teacher, or what the balance is. And it's very much in your face in comparison to what it was in the past. It wouldn't have been questioned. But so there's, it creates a tension as well for this, for people.
That's my sense.
It's certainly some of the priests I work with, they're very conscious not to lay a hand on a child. Bishop Eugene talks about it a lot. He will never be in the presence of a woman or a child by himself. Yeah. And he says, for him, it's not so much about false accusation, it's about he never wants to give anyone an opportunity even to look. He's had his whole clerical life conducted that way.
And well, I think Virgin as a male, that was drummed into us.
Okay.
There's nothing new. That's always been the case. And I must say, that's one thing struck me since becoming principal. Well, in that situation, my office is down a long corridor by itself. The first thing I did was get windows installed into the door as soon as I walked into that school. I positioned regularly.
Yeah.
Every time I felt very uncomfortable.
Okay.
And practices. So a practice is a female staff member. Can be interpreted as caring, kindly, generous, and a male can behave in exactly the same way, and the language used to describe it can be very different. And I'm very aware of that, and it's disappointing and challenging, I think, for male members of staff.
Yeah. I said the group this morning, I'll say it now, and I think Yana's point is such an important one. One of my sadnesses, I mean, but one of my sadnesses about where we are right now is that we have men, whether they be clergy, religious, or lay, who are inhibited in their relationships with children because of a fear of an accusation. I absolutely understand the fear. That makes me sad. That makes me sad for my husband and my brother and my sons, and makes me sad. What makes me sadder is that we have numbers and numbers and numbers of children, boys, being raised by women. And I was raised, mum raised us by herself, and my stepsons were raised with us. And one of the beliefs I have is that women can parent children and boys well. Women can't help boys be men. We need men to help boys be men. I think women can parent well, but I think that there is something that unique that happens in a boy-man relationship that helps boys be men. And we have an army of men who might be available to do that work and have done it in the past. Clergy and religious are one of them, who are untied with other relationships to do that, and they can't. It would be a brave man that would round up the local kids in their neighbourhood or their block of flats, particularly kids who don't have dads, and take them down to play a game of cricket. Or, I have a type of football where there might be physical contact. That makes me very sad. Makes me sad for all those boys.
It's an extra pressure on males in schools too, just that point. Particularly primary schools. The pressure on the males in primary schools, I imagine, I'm a secondary school teacher, is enormous. Because a lot of mums say, how fantastic is that? We've got a male teacher, someone who can raise our boys. And if they're coming from that background, you know, it's great to have that. And then that's a lot of pressure on that male teacher as well.
It makes me sad. I know how much our boys grew when Mick, my family, men ride motorbikes, and so do a lot of our friends. And these dads and boys... camps would go up riding motorbikes out up the creeks and sit around campfires and do whatever it is that boys and men do around campfires. And the boys would come back
the better for it. You know, they'd come back with this better. They'd learnt shed talk, they'd learnt pay talk in front of it. They just learnt lots of stuff. So it makes me sad. And so your point about attachment, I'm interested to hear. What is it, what the school's perspective, is that possible? Is that as possible as it might have been in the past?
I think a lot of it relies on the individuals. There is that. You can have the attachment, but you have to ensure that the boundaries are there so that nothing is crossed. But a lot of it is just listening. Having the students know that you care, you're prepared to listen to them and to act on their behalf in the situation. I think that's... there's a possibility or there's the opportunity there to have that relationship, to have a relationship with them.
Yeah.
It's not questionable.
Mm.
But that's supportive. And that's what it is. It's what they know, need to have their support.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Any other comments, questions about that?
Well, you can do it, but it's incredibly difficult. It's so much more difficult.
Mm.
Because we're there. What's most important is what's happening in your classroom. Sort of first and foremost, and all the other stuff that now is on schools, the pressure on schools is immense.
Mm.
And the stress of that causes immense, but you can still do it.
Yeah,
now, we have a number of programs that we run for young men,
mm.
one for year 8, 9, and one for year 10.
Mm.
But they're enormous, how much effort they have to put into
mm.
them. But you still do it.
Yeah.
It is the case that many students do go through primary school now without a male teacher.
Mm.
And I know quite often there'd be one male in a school, and I know that many males would look at the school and say, I'm going to be the only one there. I like that.
Wow, okay.
So I'll apply for it and have a couple of males around. So mm. just for camaraderie of anything, and say, you know, mm. don't end up with the person who's always on the roof giving balls down or something like that.
I think, as Red said, the resources, though, is a big thing. You know, the schools are so stretched that, you know, the resources are limited to some capacity.
Mm.
Mm. I think schools, it's different from attachment, but I think schools provide a stability and a role model for children that, if you come from a really vulnerable family situation, that's immeasurable
mm.
stability and role model.
Mm.
You know, if you come from vulnerability and chaos.
Mm. Yeah, school provides.
That's different again from attachment. The kids from those kind of situations can be quite attached to their school system or
mm.
the people, even though it's not that intimate relationship. Yeah.
Mm. Because that. I was describing about the role I think boys need that would then bring many people into conflict with point three, the principle three. Dangers the boundaries between personal and service relationships are blurred. That's such a fine line to walk, isn't it? We don't, in current climate, we can't afford fine lines. We need big barriers. Big barriers. Windows indoors, not being alone with someone, never being by yourself in a car. Any other comments? Oh, tell me about imbalance of power, because teachers, in particular in school, or teachers, there's a power imbalance there. How? What would be the demonstration if I was going to audit schools, cafe? What would I see that would tell me that you understand the problems which can occur, the imbalance of power, and how you would rectify the problem?
Policy, process, practice.
Okay.
Repeat it over and over.
So practice is kind of tangible, that's an outcome. What would I see? What would I be seeing?
Well, we have organisations within the school where the students have an opportunity to speak up to be heard.
Okay.
So.
But we also follow the restorative practices, as Rhett said before, so that actually gives the student a voice, even if they have an issue about someone who has unforeseen power over them.
Okay.
Yeah, and that voice is, I think, that you used is, yeah, whose voice is in the theory? Yeah.
Okay.
And that should be representative of the community.
Okay. All right. Any other comments? I'm conscious of the time, so I'll move this along. So let's go to point four. Church workers reach out to those who are poor, alienated and marginalised. So once again, what would I see? What would I see if I took a walk through any of your ministries? Catholic Care, the admin office of CAFED, schools?
Probably, and Greg alluded to it before, in the sense it's the priority that the school puts its resources to.
Mm-hmm.
It could be a compassionate sense of putting missions for poor families. Not just to publicise it, but actually to get in touch with the families and say them if they know you're doing that situation. It can be the emphasis they place on kids who do need extra attention,
mm-hmm.
and how well that starts, and the resources it's provided.
Okay.
So they're visible things that you can see.
Yep, okay.
What else might I see? What would I see in Catholic Care?
Hmm?
Not enough of us to answer, is there?
That's your turn.
As an outsider, if I'm allowed to comment, if I went into a school, I would like to, the people that I would very quickly identify who could be alienated or marginalised, some of the disadvantaged or disabled or that, to see them happy, I think is a real proof. I don't want any more than that. If they're happy coming to school and if they, you know, they're not sitting on their own stuck in a corner somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
I think you can't get better proof than that. You know, the marginalised. They're the ones I know because they're physically visible.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how you measure the others, but of course the other thing about that is always relied when I was at school on the librarians and the groundsmen.
They're the ones that really know.
See the people who ask that. That's where you get
all your
info. I didn't know that. Geez, if I'm ever
an auditor,
I'll know that.
That was my source of information. Like somebody had been in trouble and then I'd go to the library or the groundsman is great at it. Because he'd see them sitting somewhere. And if he got really worried, he'd come in and tell somebody. You know, like,
yeah.
And that's how you identify your marginalised and your alienated. And if they're happy to come back to school tomorrow,
there's
a lot of them at school.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I'm really important.
I think you
can tell, mate.
I think you can tell by the percentage of poor in the school,
mm-hmm.
and that gives an indication whether the school is welcoming to the poor.
Yeah, okay.
Because the community impression could be that's a school for only the others that are able or rich enough to attend.
Yeah.
So it all depends on that welcome, how people perceive that welcome.
Okay. Gain the time. Let's go to the last one. Church workers strive for excellence in the performance of their work. What would I see?
Hard-working staff.
I work with staff, not sitting around staff rooms.
A whole lot of master's of education degrees sitting on walls.
I remember going to a workshop about, it would be 20 years ago now, more than 20, and it was at a preschool and we're all volunteers on the council. And in the workshop, we were given a very, it would be 22 years ago, 24 years ago, but we were given a very good induction into our roles. And the message was very clear that just because you're volunteers doesn't mean that you behave professionally in your role. So mine was treasurer. It was the job that I said I couldn't do, so they gave me that job. But it was about, just because you're volunteers, you have a particular role to play in this organisation. It was a preschool, and it must be done to the best of your ability and according to standards. And that was sort of a different way, and I think the church applies there, if you're good and well-meaning, that's enough. But communities don't exist like that anymore, that being well-meaning and nice and good is not good enough, that, there's a lot more to participation. Mm. Yeah.
That's a really good point. If we take it outside of the ministries we have here, this applies to every church volunteer, every reader, everyone who turns up at the parish church to clean. This applies to everybody, and that's well, Rose would know better than me. That's not always going to be an easy sell. In fact, we all, or many of them, have any contact with the kitchen evoker cards. In some states, there's been uprising. And I'll tell you a story. The nuncio refused to do a children's check. I'm not. Refused, because didn't we know that who he was, and he refused to have a children's working children check, which caused the Archbishop some embarrassment. So there you go. We think we're a church that. I think so. I think that meant they took schools off the agenda.
No, we're just smiling here. That's why I'm not on the cleaning roster in my local parish.
Which one of the
church workers do not operate beyond the limits of their I never wash the linen because it would come back with red dye through the body or yellow spots. So I like that one. I'll show that to Father Roy.
Sounds like
I think there's a place, though. We talk about, say, be volunteers, but there's a place for whatever the other system is that isn't volunteers to be, employed people to be. But volunteers have the same, not the same rights, but they have rights, and that's really for us as church workers. We want to treat them with utmost respect and equality. And I think that's sometimes a challenge.
Mm.
We talk about that professional and volunteer. I think one of the bugs that's getting me at the minute is volunteers who are volunteering and not told about what they're volunteering for and what it brings with it in terms of demands and what we're going to do to help you to meet the cleaning
demands. Yeah.
You say, you'll be good at that, but you don't define the tasks, you don't define the expectations, and then when people get a bit overboard or something, it's all hell breaks them. But it's partly leaders' responsibility. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
We're not hobby at
sailing forth to fix it in your new role, right?
We've got a lot of it. But I think we don't. We don't treat them as professionals. You wouldn't bring someone else in to do a job without having some sort.
I think that counter argument to that is sometimes our expectations of volunteers is far beyond what they thought they were signing up for.
Yeah.
We expect a lot of volunteers.
sort of out with them what they
do. That brings us to the end of the business part of the workshop. I'm going to make a couple of wrap-up comments, but while I'm doing that, have a little think, because the last thing we're going to do before we leave is I'm going to ask you to feedback. As a result of things that we've talked about in the last 2 hours, what's one thing that you can take back to your workplace that you think you could change or do better or be more mindful of in relation to integrity and service of the church? That's the one thing. So while you're gathering your thoughts, I'll just make a final comment or two. The child protection standards for our church, which will be a document not unlike this, that will go across all ministries, that will roll out sometime, 3 months, 6 months, and it will be outcome focused. So in order to meet those standards at audit, you'll be, unless the bishops change it, but what I've heard is that they're going to adopt it as it's been written, is that you'll be expected to show, to demonstrate how you're doing it. So it's not just that you have a code of conduct or that you've implementing it, or not just that you have a process, a procedure, but it's that show me the evidence of where you've had to use it and what was the outcome. It'll be that kind of, not just is it there, is it how is it being actioned and what's the effectiveness of it. So it's just my word going forward. It was a bit of a heads up. I think that's the nature of auditing we're going to.
With the rollout of that document, will there be professional development around that?
My guess is that it will be rolled out and it will be up to each diocese or ministry to professionally develop their staff in relation to it, same as we've had to do with this.
Yep.
That's what I imagine. With then there being something that goes back to that company, saying we've done. That would be what I imagine would have to do. Okay, so on that note, a few minutes of reflection, what is the one thing that you think you can take back to your workplace and do better, do differently, or do?
I think to actually raise this with staff, and sometimes I'm representing the school here tonight, to be able to teach the teacher, go back and let them know about some of the historical stuff you've taught us today. And well, you know, a lot of people in the school would not know this document exists. They certainly know about Sharon's vision. That's something they will get upon their employment. But to actually unpack some of it so they're aware of what it is that, you know. And because no doubt if they've they get questions, like principal get questions sometimes about some of these things from a parent that might have concerns, so you interview and ask those sort of questions. Well, you know, what's the school's response to some of these things? No doubt some of the teachers get that too, to give them a bit of bit of knowledge, bit of background, so they can respond to appropriate terms.
Okay. What else? Other ideas? What you're going to do?
I think you challenge about saying what's the behaviour to evidence is one that I would take back. We've been doing some work on, you know, evidencing our venues, and it's hard work.
Okay.
But I think it's a worthwhile process.
Mm. So, certainly, if we have outside auditors, that's where it's going to go, because the church has been able to say we have all these processes in place. As if we have these, we don't get abuse. In fact, we have had this and we have had abuse, so it won't wash, I don't think. Just one more. One more and then we'll wrap it up. Unless you think you're doing it as perfectly as you can possibly do it.
I think that continuously we need to be ensuring that people aren't operating beyond the limits of their competence and qualifications.
Mm.
That whole point of that grey area. And especially those that are in leadership in schools, that's a responsibility that we hold.
Which I think is really tough. Certainly my profession does not do it well. We put
new, inexperienced social workers into positions well beyond them, well before them. And we cripple, we lose confidence, and get stuck.
Okay, so folks, we're at time. Thank you for today. Thank you for the opportunity, Greg, for doing this today. I really appreciate your input. Okay, the option of small group or large group, and people started as large groups, so we continued. Been very quiet up there in Skype. I hope that you've picked up some of this. Thank you. Thank you for being there patiently.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, folks, go forth and
see you, Dar.
Go ahead, Helen.
Thank you.
Bye.
Daniel.
Ben.
Thank you.
Bye.
Yeah. Are those people already on the Wix going simply?
No, they were on. As I said, can you make sure the document you've received has Catholic Education Office on the front of it? Otherwise, some of the numbers won't match up later on when we're talking about them.
So, hopefully before you, what you have are three things. You have an integrity and service of the church. Blue one, you have just the orange one. And you just have this one pager, which is really just a quick reference. So, how integrity and service of the church is written. There's a preamble. Then it lays out five preamble. The preamble includes what should happen if there's a breach of the guidelines. And then it goes through five principles that are the basis of this. And each principle is introduced by a piece from the gospel or a comment in relation to the gospel. I hate it when people are read aloud to me because I can read myself. So I'll let you read. Don't read. This is probably the quickest thing to read. Yeah. Just read and we'll come back to it to 12. I'll give you 5 minutes or a few minutes to read it.
Our digital friends only lost 5 minutes.
Ah, they're back. Okay. Thank you. Us, or did they hear us?
No, we had a computer issue.
You might want to tell the ones on Skype that to read through the email version of this.
For those of you who are on Skype, can you hear me? Can you just wave if you can hear me?
We can hear you, but can't see you.
Oh, okay. So waving is not going to help you, is it? No.
That's the one that was emailed.
One of the documents.
We actually don't know. We don't know what you can see, Orange.
Yeah, we just lost.
I can see Diane and I can see everybody.
Hi, Diane.
The documents we're looking at, there's a blue covered one called Integrity and Service of the Church, and Greg emailed that to you. Yesterday, your hard copies are here. Oh, this morning.
Yeah.
Your hard copies are here, but you have an email one that Greg sent this morning.
Yep. Yes.
Yep.
We do.
Good. And then Damien asked if you could find the sharers of the vision documents to have it in front of you.
Yep.
Yep.
Yep. And I think,
but we want the one without the picture at the bottom. We want the one that has for admin staff. I think you're looking, Diane. I think you're looking at the one for teaching staff.
That's maybe.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Yep. And the third document, I think Greg also emailed, yes, which is a one page back and front, which is an overview of integrity and service of the church.
No, don't have that.
Okay. We'll start with some general comments, then we'll move to some more specific comments. What jumps out at you when you read either or both of those documents, Integrity and Service of the Church and the Cathed Chairers of the Vision? What would be your opening comments you would make?
Catholic social justice.
Catholic social justice from both? Both, okay. This one, remembering, Integrity and Service of the Church is written across to apply to all ministries. All ministries, whereas yours has been mapped. Both about social justice is one comment. What other comments would you make?
Very much about protection of the vulnerable.
Yeah, protection of the vulnerable. Yeah, both of them, or?
I was reading the summary sheet.
Yeah. Yep.
So they're the headings for this stuff.
Yeah.
In section 3, I find interesting about the responsibility that the worker has to take their own professionalism.
Yeah. So point 3 in here. Principle 3. Mm-hmm. And principle 5, hey, also about making sure they're personally and professionally competent. Similar. One of the things that I guess because I work with codes of conduct across various entities and codes of ethics, when I look at the integrity of service of the church, for me it's just a blur of words. They're words that, if I leave out church workers, you can pick up and use this in any helping profession organisation pretty much. And I guess that's designed to be, but I don't find this a document that particularly grabs me in knowing how to action it. Like, what do you do? What are we actually just called to do? So I do find your document a little more focused, which is good. That would be the comment I would make. But then this one's not designed to apply to every ministry specifically. Now, going forward, and when we go to auditing, we'll be audited against this. I'm assuming this will be one of the documents we'll be audited against because we don't have any others yet. So where we're going to go to now, we're going to imagine I'm the auditor and that I'm visiting your ministries. And so here I am, I'm auditing you against principle 1. Church workers are committed to justice and equity. So I arrive at your ministry and I say, show me, show me how you do this. Show me how you every day in your work achieving principle 1. What could you show me? What could you give me to demonstrate that you're doing? Now we can do this as a large group or small group, such as large group. What's your preference? Small? Large? Sorry, Jim?
I was just going to make a comment.
Okay.
I suppose one of the things that we would be able to show is that we have a school code of conduct. We're constantly reminding all the school community about it. And we, in particular as leaders, we're reminding the staff to ensure that it is enacted, which is all about fairness and justice.
Okay. And we play devil's advocate. And as an evaluator, I say, that's great. You're showing me an input. You're showing me that you have a code of conduct. You're showing me some throughput. You're showing me what you're doing. What would I see? We'll direct this to all of you. Get Jim a point. What would I see as an outcome? What would I see that says, yes, as a result of the code of conduct and us constantly reminding staff, we are seeing a high level of professional conduct? What would I see? What would I see as the impact on? Because you could be an organisation that has a code of conduct, does lots of reminding, but it's not behaving properly, just and equitable. So what would I see that tells me it had an impact?
Actually, the way people deal with each other.
Okay, what would I be looking for?
If you happen to be in the front office of the school, you'd see a lot of interaction, whether it was staff, parents, teachers, students.
Okay.
And you would be looking at the way, the manner in which people dealt with each other.
Okay. All right.
Behaviour management policies.
Okay. What would those behaviour management policies be? What would a good one say? What would it be demonstrating?
When you're dealing with a behaviour management issue, we have a restorative justice's approach, real justice, and that you want approaches. How that's taken in your cases, because it's all about justice and fairness.
Okay. All right.
Transparency and consistency of applications.
Okay, regardless of the child, regardless of the school, would be the same?
No, because that might be part of the fairness, it's the context-specific application, but it would be transparency and consistency in responding to it.
Okay. Now, that's an interesting point. The group this morning talked about that in order for something to be just, it may not be equal. So how would, if I was going to one of your schools that's dealing with a particularly disadvantaged community, location, what would I see that I mightn't see in another school? Demonstrate equity. What I see is different.
Support services, other support services that are coming into the school from CEO or others.
Okay. So I might see more of those around, more ancillary support,
When certain resources in the school are allocated.
Okay, what does that mean?
If you've got a large group of disadvantaged students, it might be low ethnic background, low literacy and numeracy, the school may allocate additional resources to those students to try to bring that up as quickly as possible.
Okay.
Choice within the school about how they allocate the resources.
Okay. All right. What else?
You might see different groups of people that are part of decision-making processes. It might look different in different contexts.
Okay. Give me an example.
Well, in a, say, in an urban school, you'd have a whole lot of representative groups who participate in decision-making about the behaviour management policy in a community. That representative group would still be evident, but it might be different irrespective of the community who's represented. So like we have a board, but it looks very different in an urban context, a representative board, than it might in, say, an Indigenous community.
What I see in Catholic care? If I'm the auditor of Catholic care, what would I see?
I'm at the principle three, the third principle. The church workers are committed to safe and supportive relationship. For me, this is the most important one. And you said that the principle is church workers to observe, I mean, to know and to understand and to respect. How you're making people to know and to understand and to respect. So how you support the workers to understand and to know and to respect, and how they can observe all this so they can comply with all this. Not just write down that you should do that, you should do this, but how you support workers not to do in the opposite way.
Okay, yeah. Well, and let's just continue this conversation on point three. So what would I see then? Like, what would I see that would tell me Catholic care is supporting workers to do it justly? What would I see?
Professional development and a supervision. I mean, you cannot work with people in the right way, and you cannot support parents or children in your role if you don't have professional development as supervision. You need to develop yourself as a professional when working with people, so you can be very clear with the boundaries which is the third. And I think the problem with all the abuse of the children is basically the, you know, physical, emotional boundaries and blurring of these boundaries. This is a basic problem that happened.
That's right. Yeah.
And from my perspective, it's not just the victim, it's the child. The victim also is the person that committed. So perpetrators should also be treated as a victim for their own history. And how we are not support them not to do the same, because you have a modeling from adults. If you were abused, you will abuse another person. Mm-hmm. This is the model that you learn in your life. So you need to gain a different kind of personal experience,
mm-hmm.
like emotional relationship. And teachers and people in school are quite important from the perspective of attachment theory.
Mm-hmm.
So if you didn't have a bonding of attachment in your primary family, you could gain this in school
mm-hmm.
from a person that is quite important for you. It could be a teacher, it could be a principal, it could be, you know, this is quite important. So the role in the school is a very responsible and important role if you are obliged yourself to do this kind of job. So it's an easy one.
It's a really good point. I'll pick that up when we get over to Principle 3, because I think that it's getting harder and harder for schools to be able to pick up some of that work now. It's what I see from the outside, but we'll come back to that if that's okay. Just wanting to allow our time a little bit. Okay. Any comments from the Skype people? No? Just butt in if you have any comments. Let's go to Principle 2. So, church workers uphold the dignity of all people and their right to respect. Again, I'm walking through your schools or ministries. What would I see? What's your tangible evidence that you're doing this?
I guess it is that basic thing of how you communicate to your parent community and your student community and your agencies that are working in your school, that if you're yelling and screaming and all that, that's not exactly what that's saying. So then we have to be treating you in respect on a daily occurrence. So
mm-hmm.
it's a very simple modelling of our behaviour.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, what the phrase that jumps out at me, I'm always conscious when I'm talking to a bunch of teachers that, I'm not sure if it's a phrase or three words, but anyway, three words here that jump out at me, diversity and difference.
And embrace diversity.
Yes, so we're embracing diversity and difference. Now, this morning I raised this point and was told that your school's current stats, 53% of students have English language other than English as their first language. Is that right?
Yeah, from the stats that we discussed yesterday, according to ACARA, but we expect it would be much higher than that, obviously, in Indigenous Catholic community schools, but that's what's on the course.
So more than half of the pupils in your school, students in your school, come from diverse, different. What would I see? I don't know what's it like for Catholic care. What would your numbers run at? Yes? No, that's okay. That's right. Let's stay with schools. So what would I see that would tell me that you're embracing diversity and difference in regard to cold communities?
It can be as simple as the practicalities of interpreters, the way you set up the parent meetings, so that, you know, your interpreter sits here and they can sit with them.
Mm.
And that's freely available to parent teacher interviews, read and reports, all those sort of processes as well. Certainly the process of, obviously, I've taught many multicultural schools, and that celebrating the cultures that are within the school in some way, especially Harmony Day is quite celebrated here in the Northern Territory, but certainly I've worked in schools with high African numbers, so we do celebrate some of the festivals and ceremonies and that are part of that culture too. It's a big part of your school.
Mm, okay. What could you do better? Do you think you're doing it as well as you could, or could it be better?
My response to that would be, I think the use of interpreters could be better here in the Northern Territory.
Okay.
But our system's right, that parents would know how to get an interpreter if they need one.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that's something that probably picks a little bit up here.
Okay. One of the suggestions that came out this morning was that it might be helpful to send the key important school notices out in languages other than English. Key languages so that parents weren't relied on kids first remembering to give them the note or translating it for them.
Interesting, there's some recent research that actually said, we looked at the parents.
They don't
want to hear, and that where they wrote the newsletter, and they said, no, we chose to bring home the newsletter written in English.
Okay.
That it was embarrassing.
Ah, righto.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
It's much easier to talk to a relative and pretend that they could do the language there.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, that's what they wanted to engage in that context. Yeah.
Well, that's interesting.
And maybe the translations aren't very good. I don't know. There might have been lots of roots.
Yeah.
And there's time frame behind it as well. By the time you get off to the interpreting service, get it back.
I think that in order to embrace diversity and difference, you really do need to know the people in your class or in your year level or in your school. So taking time to get to know the families and to know more than just their name and their number.
Mm-hmm.
Because how can you embrace diversity if you don't know the first thing about families? And I think we have to work further than the classroom. We have to be interested further than the classroom.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it's impossible.
Is it doable? Is that doable to get to know kids and their families more than in the classroom?
Is it doable?
Mm-hmm.
I think that it is doable to a certain extent. I think that aspire to doing it in order to do it to any degree. If we don't believe that it's important, then obviously we won't achieve any part of that. I really truly believe it's part of what we're called to do in Catholic education. I was just looking through and looking at the actual dot points in here that don't appear in here and wondering why there's some that aren't. Does it mean that these aren't important enough to be here, or were they missed in our initial conversation? So, and whether or not it's because it's not doable, or whether it's not important, or whether it's not seen as part of our charter any longer. So
I might have explained it badly. So are you wondering why parts of this are not included in this?
Parts, the dot points in here, like I can imagine that not all of these need to be included in here. That's true, because that would have been part of the discussions that were had. But I'm interested in the reason behind why they aren't in there, or why they weren't come to the attention in order to be included.
Yeah, I do.
I just asked, it's the opposite to what you're asking about, whether it's doable, and my response being,
is that one not included?
No, that if they're doable or not is not really the question. It's whether or not we aspire to doing it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We might not be able to do all of it or do it really to the level we want, but is it something we still aspire to do? And then that linked me to, so if these points don't appear in here, does it mean that we're not aspiring to do that, or they were just missed, or they hold little importance? That's the question I suppose I throw back in response.
And I must have not been clear. This document preceded this document. Oh, sorry. This document preceded this one.
Yeah.
And there's been no process by which this blue one, which is this one,
Yeah, but I'm looking at the sharers of the vision.
Yes.
Here. And the ones that are missing on this document.
Oh, better in the bacteria.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And
sorry.
So I'm saying, like, you know, do we still aspire to all of these? And I'm just interested in why some of them aren't in here.
So you're going to come to me. My memory of it, this is 3 years ago, is that when we did the mapping exercise, it was to make sure that what was in the integrity in the services of the church was picked up in our shares of the vision. But there are additional things in our shares of the vision, and we weren't mapping. It has been rewritten or new thoughts included, but I was trying to think back whether it was 2013 or 2014. If there were things in the shares of the vision that didn't actually map into this cleanly, they were left out.
Yeah.
They weren't left out because they weren't important. It was the intent when we first did the mapping was to make sure everything that was here was somewhere picked up in this document. But there are additional things in this document as well.
Okay.
Yeah. So nothing was regarded as not being important. Mm-hmm. But we wanted to make sure that if this document is a key document from the church's perspective, for lady working in the church, that we needed to know that all of these headings were picked up in shares of the vision. And so that's the way the mapping was done.
I suppose when I look at this, I would say that some of these points are difficult to achieve. They are doable to probably a lesser extent than what we would desire, but still we aspire to them, you know.
Yeah.
So it's there's a lot of things in life like that, I suppose.
Yeah, I know, and certainly nothing wrong with being aspirational.
And I suppose in point two, the challenge for us is our prejudices and our biases. And I suppose when I look at different faces of families and children in our schools, there would be some that would question 2.2.
Okay.
So if you're a child with same-sex parents, if you're a child dealing with transgender issues, if you're a child who has a parent who perhaps has been incarcerated, you know, you can think of a whole lot of different faces in our schools that I think would perhaps challenge 2.2. We've got a lot of work, I think.
Yeah.
As a community, church
community.
Okay. It's probably generational issues too, isn't it? Just even in a staff group, there's generational issues.
And some of the language that we use, and sometimes that just requires a lot of education about how we talk about humanity, the language that we use to, that requires, I think, a lot of professional learning because it's not through a lack of intent. I'd say there's a lot of intent. Sometimes it's the ignorance and the capacity of people to engage in the issues that are very important.
Language is such an important thing, doesn't it? Language changes. Language is... I work around the country. And there are some states that if I called Australian Indigenous people Aboriginal, I would be criticised.
Mm-hmm.
At times in the Territory, when I work in here, if I call Aboriginal people Indigenous, I'm in trouble. In Queensland, if I were to use the language Koori, I'd be in trouble. If I was a white woman in some circles, use the words Murray, I'd be in trouble. Like sometimes I think, what is the right word?
Yep.
And what was okay 5 years ago is not okay now. So I think that's a really good point of just having updated what is the appropriate language. And I think there is an accusation that can be made about political correctness, but it is about culture changes, doesn't it? And how we include people changes, and language is one of them. But it's not easy.
And it's not particular to the church, because we know that our political leaders are really struggling to frame some of the issues with the language of what you would expect in leadership. Yeah, so it's not specific to the church. I think it's a global.
Let's go on to 3.3. I think this is an interesting one. And I'll take up the point just check on that. So what was your first name?
Yelena.
Yelena, sorry. Yelena raised about that schools, there's about 30 different points we could raise out of this, but we'll use Yelena's because it's an interesting entree. So Yelena's point was that schools can be a place where kids' needs for attachment can be met. And in the absence of any other opportunity, that might be the place they need. And my comment was, I think it's more difficult to do that these days than it was in the past, Mark. And the reason I think that is because I think, particularly for men, we've reached this time in our society's history where men, rightly so, are worried about false accusation. And we've also reached this time that all professions are doing it, which is very strong boundaries between providers of a service and recipients of a service, social workers and clients, teachers, students, and that in some, the word this morning was used as aloof, that often now us as whichever caring or helping or teaching role we're in might appear to be aloof. It's because we've created this big boundary.
I just find that amusing to some degree because that was one of the accusations made against clergy in the past, particularly members of religious orders, that they tended to be aloof, that they didn't engage the children, and that they lacked that human loving touch. So gone through a whole period and we're back where we started, only we're back where we started with lay people rather than religious orders. Just an observation.
Yeah. Well, let's start out with the proposition I make and that we're talking about. What's your views about that? Where do you think we're at the moment for us as people working with people who are less powerful than us?
I think people are very conscious of it, that of creating that distance. I've numerous staff who say, you know, they won't be in a room on their own, they won't do this, or if I'm taking an excursion or camp, should I take another male teacher, should I take a female teacher, or what the balance is. And it's very much in your face in comparison to what it was in the past. It wouldn't have been questioned. So it creates tension as well for this people.
That's my sense. It's certainly to the priests I work with. They're very conscious not to lay a hand on a child. Bishop Eugene talks about it a lot. He will never be in the presence of a woman or a child by himself. And he says, for him, it's not so much about false accusation, it's about he never wants to give anyone an opportunity even to wonder. He's had his whole clerical life conducted that way. And well, I think.
Imagine as a male, that was drummed into us.
Okay.
There's nothing new. That's always been the case. And I must say that's one thing struck me since becoming principal. Well, in that situation, my office is down a long corridor by itself. First thing I did was get windows installed into the door as soon as I walked into that school, which I position regularly.
Yeah.
Every time I feel very uncomfortable.
Okay.
And practices. So a practice is a female staff member. Can be interpreted as caring, kindly, generous, and a male can behave in exactly the same way, and the language used to describe it can be very differently. And I'm very aware of that, and it's disappointing and challenging, I think, for male members of staff.
Yeah. I said to the group this morning, and I'll say it now, and I think Yelena's point is such an important one. One of my sadnesses, one of my sadnesses about where we are right now is that we have men, whether they be clergy, religious, or lay, who are inhibited in their relationships with children because of a fear of an accusation. I absolutely understand the fear. That makes me sad. That makes me sad for my husband and my brother and my sons, and makes me sad. What makes me sadder is that we have numbers and numbers and numbers of children, boys, being raised by women. Mum raised us by herself, and my stepsons were raised with us. And one of the beliefs I have is that women can parent children and boys well. Women can't help boys be men. We need men to help boys be men. I think women can parent well, but I think that there is something that unique that happens in a boy-man relationship that helps boys be men. And we have an army of men who might be available to do that work and have done it in the past. Clergy and religious are one of them, who are untied with other relationships to do that, and they can't. It would be a brave man that would round up the local kids in their neighbourhood or their block of flats, particularly kids who don't have dads, and take them down to play a game of cricket. Or, I hope it's football, but there might be physical contact. That makes me very sad. Makes me sad for all those boys.
It's an extra pressure on males in schools too, just that point. Mm. Particularly primary schools. The pressure on the males in primary schools, I imagine, I'm a secondary school teacher, is enormous. Because a lot of mums say, how fantastic is that? We've got a male teacher, someone who can raise our boys. And if they're coming from that background, it's great to have that. And then that's a lot of pressure on that male teacher as well.
It makes me sad. I know how much our boys grew when Mick, my family, men ride motorbikes, and so do a lot of our friends. And his dads and boys... camps would go up riding motorbikes out up the creeks and sit around campfires and do whatever it is that boys and men do around campfires. And the boys would come back the better for it. You know, they'd come back with this better. They'd learnt shed talk, they'd learnt how you talk in front of it. They just learnt lots of stuff. So it makes me sad. And so your point about attachment, I'm interested to hear what for school's perspective, is that possible? Is that as possible as it might have been in the past?
I think a lot of it relies on the individuals. But there is that. You can have the attachment, but you have to ensure that the boundaries are there so that nothing is crossed. But a lot of it is just listening, having the students know that you care. You're prepared to listen to them and to act on their behalf in a situation. I think there's a possibility or there's the opportunity there to have that relationship, to have a relationship with them.
Yeah.
It's not questionable.
Mm.
But, that's supportive, and that's what it is. It's what they know each other's support.
Okay. Yeah. Any other comments, questions about that?
You can do it, but it's incredibly difficult. It's so much more difficult because we're there. What's most important is what's happening in your classroom. It's what we're there first and foremost, and all the other stuff that now is on schools, the pressure on schools is immense, and the stress of that causes is immense, but you can still do it.
Yeah,
now, we have a number of programs that we run for young men, one for year 8, 9, and one for year 10, but they're enormous. How much effort you have to put into them. But you still do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
It is the case that many students do go through primary school now without a male teacher.
Mm.
And I know quite often there'd be one male in a school. And I know that many males will look at the school and say, I'm going to be the only one there. I won't go there.
Wow, okay.
I'll apply for it. It's another couple of males around. Just for camaraderie of anything, and say, you know, and end up the person who's always on the roof giving the balls down or something like that.
I think, as Red said, the resources, though, is a big thing. You know, the schools are so stretched that, you know, the resources are limited, so capacity.
Mm.
I think schools, it's different from attachment, but I think schools provide a stability and a role model for children that. If you come from a really vulnerable family situation, that's immeasurable stability and role model. You know, if you come from vulnerability and chaos,
Yeah, school provides.
There's different kinds of attachment. The kids from those kind of situations can be quite attached to their school system or the people, even though it's not that intimate relationship. Yeah. Mm.
Because that, when I was describing about the role I think boys need, that would then bring many people into conflict with point three, the principle three. Dangers the boundaries between personal and service relationships are blurred. That's such a fine line to walk, isn't it? We don't, in current climate, we can't afford fine lines. We need big barriers. Big barriers. Windows indoors, not being alone with someone, never being by yourself in a car. Any other comments? Oh, talking about imbalance of power, because teachers, in particular in school, or teachers, there's a power imbalance there. How? What would be the demonstration if I was going to audit schools, cafe? What would I see that would tell me that you understand the problems which can occur, the imbalance of power, and how you would rectify the problem?
Policy, process, practice.
Okay.
Repeat it over.
So practice is kind of tangible, that's an outcome. What would I see? What would I be seeing?
Well, we have organisations within the school where students have an opportunity to speak up, to be heard.
Okay.
So.
But we also follow the restorative practices, as Rhett said before. So that actually gives the student a voice, even if they have an issue about someone who has, of course, power over them.
Okay.
Yeah, and that voice is, I think, that you used is, yeah, whose voice is in the hearing? Yeah.
Okay.
And that should be represented with the community.
Okay. All right. Any other comments? I'm conscious of the time, so I'll move this along. So let's go to point four. Church workers reach out to those who are poor, alienated and marginalised. So once again, what would I see? What would I see if I took a walk through any of your ministries? Catholic Care, the admin office of CAFED schools?
Probably. Greg alluded to it before, in a sense, it's the priority that the school puts its resources to.
Mm-hmm.
It could be a compassionate sense of putting missions for poorer families, and not just to publicise it, but actually to get in touch with the families and say that they know you're doing that situation. It can be the emphasis they place on kids who do need extra attention,
mm-hmm.
and how well that starts. The resources it's provided.
Okay.
So they're visible things that you can see.
Yep. Okay. What else might I see? What would I see in Catholic Care?
Not enough of us to answer, is there? As an outsider, if I'm allowed to comment, if I went into a school, I would like to, the people that I would very quickly identify who could be alienated or marginalised, some of the disadvantaged or disabled or that, to see them happy, I think is a real proof. I don't want any more than that. If they're happy coming to school and if they, you know, they're not sitting on their own stuck in a corner somewhere. Mm-hmm. I think you can't get better proof than that. You know, mm-hmm. The marginalised. They're the ones I know because they're physically visible. Mm-hmm. I don't know how you measure the others, but of course, the other thing about that is, always relied when I was at school on the librarians and the groundsmen.
They're the ones that really know.
See the people
who ask.
That's where you get all your
I didn't know that. Gee, if I'm ever an auditor, I'll know that.
That was my source of information. Like somebody had been troubled and then I'd go to the library or the groundsman was great metal. Because he'd see them sitting somewhere. And if we got really worried, he'd come in and tell somebody, you know, like,
yeah.
And that's how you identify your marginalised and your alienated. And if they're happy to come back to school tomorrow,
yeah, that's
so a lot of school.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Well, I'm really
I think you.
The canteen lady?
I think you can tell by the percentage of poor in the school.
Mm-hmm.
And that gives an indication whether the school is welcoming to the poor.
Yeah. Okay.
Because the community impression could be that's a school for only the others that are able or rich enough to attend.
Yeah.
So it all depends on that welcome, how people perceive that welcome.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Gauge the time. Let's go to the last one. Church workers strive for excellence in the performance of their work. What would I see?
Hard-working staff,
not sitting around staff rooms. A whole lot of masters of education degrees sitting on walls.
Mm-hmm. I remember going to a workshop about, it would be 20 years ago now. More than 20, and it was at a preschool, and we're all volunteers on the council. And in the workshop, we were given a very, 24 years ago, but we were given a very good induction into our roles. And the message was very clear that just because you're volunteers doesn't mean that you behave professionally in your role. So mine was treasurer. It was the job that I said I couldn't do, so they gave me that job. But it was about, just because you're volunteers, you have a particular role to play in this organisation. It was a preschool, and it must be done to the best of your ability and according to standards. And that was sort of a different way, you know, and I think the church applies there. You know, if you're good and well-meaning, that's enough. But communities don't exist like that anymore, that being well-meaning and nice and good is not good enough, that, you know, there's a lot more to participation. Mm. Yeah.
That's a really good point. If we take it outside of the ministries we have here, this applies to every church volunteer, every reader, everyone who turns up at the parish church to clean. This applies to everybody, and that's well, Rose would know better than me. That's not always going to be an easy sell. In fact, we all, or many of them have any contact with Kishida Boca cards. In some states, though, there's been uprising. And I'll tell you a story. The nuncio refused to do a children's check. I'm not. Refused because didn't we know who he was, and he refused to have a children's working the children check, which caused the Archbishop some embarrassment. So there you go. We think we're a church that.
So that also meant they never visited schools.
I think so. I think that meant they took schools off the agenda.
No, we're just smiling here. That's why I'm not on the cleaning roster in my local parish.
Which one of the
church workers do not operate beyond the limits of their I never wash the linen because it would come back with red dye through or yellow spots. So I like that one. I'll show that to Father Roy.
Sounds like
I think though there's a place though, you know, we talk about, say, the volunteers, but there's a place for whatever the other system is that isn't volunteers to be, you know, employed people to be, but volunteers have the same, not the same rights, but they have rights, and that's mm-hmm. union. For us as church workers, we want to treat them with utmost respect and equality. And,
mm.
and I think that's sometimes a challenge.
Mm.
You know, we talk about that professional and volunteer. And,
mm-hmm.
I think one of the bugs that's getting me at the minute is volunteers who are volunteering and not told about what they're volunteering for and what it brings with it in terms of demands and what we're going to do to help you to meet the cleaning demands.
Yeah.
You say, oh, you'll be good at that, but you don't define the tasks, you don't define the expectations, and then when people get a bit overboard or something, it's all hell breaks them. But it's partly leaders' responsibility.
Yeah.
We're sailing forth to fix it in your new role, right?
We've got a lot of it. But I think we don't. If we don't treat them as professionals, you wouldn't bring someone else in to do a job without having some sort.
I think that counter argument to that is sometimes our expectations of volunteers is far beyond what they thought they were signing up for.
Yeah.
We expect a lot of volunteers
sometimes. Sort of out with them what they
do. That brings us to the end of the business part of the workshop. I'm going to make a couple of wrap-up comments, but while I'm doing that, have a little think. Because the last thing we're going to do before we leave is I'm going to ask you to feedback. As a result of things that we've talked about in the last 2 hours, what's one thing that you can take back to your workplace that you think you could change or do better or be more mindful of in relation to integrity and service of the church? That's the one thing. So while you're gathering your thoughts, I'll just make a final comment or two. The child protection standards for our church, which will be a document not unlike this, that will go across all ministries, that will roll out sometime, 3 months, 6 months, and it will be outcome focused. So in order to meet those standards at audit, you'll be... Unless the bishops change it, but what I've heard is that they're going to adopt it as it's been written, is that you'll be expected to show, to demonstrate how you're doing it. So it's not just that you have a code of conduct or that you've implementing it, or not just that you have a process, a procedure, but it's that show me the evidence of where you've had to use it and what was the outcome. It'll be that kind of, not just, is it there? Is it how is it being actioned and what's the effectiveness of it? So it's just my word going forward. It was a bit of a heads up. I think that's the nature of auditing we're going to.
With the rollout of that document, will there be professional development around that?
My guess is that it will be rolled out and it will be up to each diocese or ministry to professionally develop their staff in relation to it, same as we've had to do with things.
Yep.
That's what I imagine. With then there being something that goes back to that company, saying we've done.
Yep.
That would be what I imagine. Okay, so on that note, a few minutes of reflection. What is the one thing that you think you can take back to your workplace and do better, do differently, or do?
I think to actually raise this with staff. Sometimes I'm representing the school here tonight to be able to teach the teacher, go back and let them know about some of the historical stuff you've taught us today. And, well, the, you know, a lot of people in the school would not know this document exists. They certainly know about Chair's vision. That's something they will get upon their employment. But to actually unpack some of it so they're aware of what it is that, you know, And because no doubt if they've they get questions, like principal get questions sometimes about some of these things from a parent that might have concerns, so you interview and ask those sort of questions, you know, what's the school's response to some of these things? No doubt some of the teachers get that too, to give them a bit of knowledge, a bit of background so they can respond to appropriately too.
Okay. What else? Other ideas, what you're going to do?
I think you challenge about saying what's the behaviour to evidence is one that I would take back. We've been doing some work on, you know, evidencing our values, and it's hard work. But I think it's a worthwhile process.
You certainly agree with outside auditors, that's where it's going to go, because the church has been able to say, we have all these processes in place. As if we have these, we don't get abuse. In fact, we have had this and we have had abuse, so that we won't wash, I don't think.
Just one more
and then we'll wrap it up. Unless you think you're doing it as perfectly as you can possibly do it.
I think that continuously we need to be ensuring that people aren't operating beyond the limits of their competence and qualifications.
Mm.
That whole point of that grey area. And especially those that are in leadership in schools, that's a responsibility that we hold.
Which I think is really tough. Certainly my profession does not do it well. We put new, inexperienced social workers into positions well beyond them, well before their times. And we cripple. We lose confidence. And get stuck. Okay, so folks, we're at time. Thank you for today. Thank you for the opportunity, Greg, for doing this today.